Yes, good morning everyone. We are going to start with the lecture. So last time we introduced heat equation and we were trying to find a solution of heat equation using method of separation of variables. So let us continue with that. So let me show you where we were. So this was a method of separation of variables, which I explained that in this you have to assume your solution to be of the product of two variables. Let me come to heat equation only. Yes. So here it was. Yes. So this was our equation. Uxx is 1 by k times del u by del t, where L is the length of the rod. And these were the boundary conditions, zero boundary conditions. The temperature at both the ends is maintained at zero for all the times. And this is some initial condition will be given to us, some function of X. So what was this method of separation of variables? It assumed that the solution looks like X into T, where capital X is a function of X only and capital T is a function of T only. And then we differentiated U with respect to T and double differentiated U with respect to X and substituted that into the original heat equation. So we get this system. And then we saw that this individually and this individually is equal to a constant. So this gives us two ordinary differential equation, equation number 5 and 6, where equation number 5 is a second order ordinary differential equation and equation number 6 is a first order differential equation. So we will come to the sixth later, but firstly let's focus on equation number 5. So this is equation number 5 written in this particular form. So now we'll be talking about solution of equation number 5. So since it's a second order, so this needs two conditions with itself. So we did this calculation last time and showed that the given original boundary conditions, which were for u, transformed to these two boundary conditions, x at 0 is 0 and x at L is 0. So we will continue from now this point onwards and solve this equation number 5. So you are having this equation now, d2x by dx2 minus omega x is 0, where these are the two different boundary conditions given to you. So now the general technique is you write auxiliary equation. You know how to already solve a second order ordinary differential equation. So this will be m square minus omega is equal to 0. So m is equal to plus minus square root of omega. Now depending upon the value of omega, you will have different roots. So case one, if omega is 0, because what was omega? You know, what was omega? It was the constant introduced by us when we were discussing this, that this is equal to omega. So omega can be any constant. It can be 0, it can be a positive number, it can be a negative number. So if you consider case 1, if omega is 0, then what are the roots of auxiliary equation? 0 0. So they are real and repeated roots or equal roots. So we know that when there are equal roots, then your solution, general solution of equation, is like, now capital X is the dependent variable. So capital X is going to be C1 plus X times C2 into e raised to power 0 times X, because 0 is the repeated root. So this is basically C1 plus X C2. So now you put the boundary conditions. So X at 0 is 0. So when you will be putting X at 0 is equal to 0 in this, what you will be getting? 0 is equal to C1 plus 0 into C2. This will give you C1 is 0. And what is the second boundary condition? X at L is 0. When you put the second boundary condition in the solution, you will get 0 is equal to C1 plus L times C2. Now C1 is already 0. So this implies L times C2 is 0. Now what is L? L is the length of the rod. That is definitely non-zero. So this implies C2 is 0. So therefore the solution is 0 solution, because the solution is C1 plus XC2, where both C1 and C2 actually are turning out to be 0. So this is x is equal to 0, but we know that this is a trivial solution, right? So we are not having any benefit of getting this solution, trivial solution. So that means we will not consider the case omega is equal to 0. The meaning of trivial solution I explained you last time. I can explain you again just for the sense of repeating it in case you have any doubt in trivial and non-trivial solution. So if I give you any differential equation, like say y double dash minus 2y dash plus 3y is equal to 0. Just take an example of any homogeneous differential equation. Then you know y is equal to 0 is always a solution to this equation. I'm just considering a different example. So because you take y is equal to 0, so y dash is also 0, y double dash is also 0, because the derivative of 0 is 0. That's a constant. So this is always a solution to this, because on the right hand side we have a 0. So, but you know, whenever we are solving it, we are trying the techniques to find a solution, we are always looking for non-trivial solution. So this being always a solution of a homogeneous differential equation, this is called a trivial solution. So we are not interested in finding these solutions, because these are by default there. We don't need to apply mathematical techniques to find these solutions. We are looking for non-trivial solutions. So that means the case one, omega is equal to 0, leads to a trivial solution. So now we will be taking case two. So case two is omega is positive, right? Because there are three possibilities for any real number, either it is zero or it is negative or it is positive. So let's take when omega is positive. So in that case, the roots of auxiliary equation which you have found above is this. So if omega is positive, this square root omega is going to be a real number. So in that case, your roots fall into the category of real roots and distinct. So when you have real and distinct roots, your solution is given by C1 times e raised to power. The first root is square root omega. The second root is minus of square root of omega into x. So this is the solution, general solution, which we get in the case omega is positive. And now again, you use the two boundary conditions. So when you will be using the first boundary condition, so this will give you 0 is equal to C1 e raised to power 0 plus C2 into e raised to power 0. That means C1 plus C2 is 0. And what will happen from the second boundary condition? You will get 0 is equal to C1 e raised to power omega L plus C2 e raised to power minus omega L. This will further equal to, if you just divide, or you can say multiply with e raised to power root omega L. So this will be this, and using these, now C2 is minus times C1, you will get C1 into e raised to power this minus 1 is 0. So this implies C1 is 0, right? Why C1 is 0? Because this part is definitely non-zero. Why this part is non-zero? Because e raised to power something is going to be equal to 1 only when the power is 0. So in the power you have omega and L, neither omega is 0, because we are in the case omega strictly greater than 0, and neither the length of the rod is 0. That's why the only possibility is C1 is 0. So when you put C1 is 0, again you look at this condition, this will further give you C2 is also 0. So that means in the second case, when omega is positive, this also leads to a trivial solution, right? This also leads to a trivial solution. So let me just go ahead with the case number three. So the case number three is your basically, which case is left? Omega is negative. So when omega is negative, the roots of auxiliary equation are plus minus square root of omega. So since omega is negative, so I am going to put omega is minus lambda, where lambda is positive. You will see this is a better convenient notation, right? It is something like, if I'm writing square root of minus 3, the same thing I can write square root of 3 into iota. So my lambda becomes 3. So omega I'm going to substitute as minus of some positive number. So this is plus minus square root of this. So this is plus minus square root of lambda into I. So these are now what kind of roots? Complex roots. And complex roots are always distinct because they are complex conjugate of each other. So we have two roots and both of them happen to be complex roots. So we know that general solution of a second order differential equation in case of complex roots is first constant into cosine of, yeah, so this is of the form a plus minus ib. So a is your zero, real part is zero. It's a purely imaginary root. And b is actually square root of lambda, if, as you can see. So this will be c1 cos root lambda x plus c2 sine root lambda x. If you remember, the solution was given by e raised to power ax into c1 cos bx plus c2 sine bx, where b is the imaginary part, a is the real part. Now there is no real part, so e raised to power 0x is actually here. So that is just 1. So we get solution c1 cos square root lambda x plus c2 sine square root lambda x. Now again, we need to use the boundary conditions. So x at 0 is 0. When you will be putting x at 0 is 0, you will substitute this, you will get 0 is equal to c1 cos 0 plus c2 sine 0. I'm putting small x is 0. So sine of 0 is 0, cos of 0 is 1. This gives you 0 is equal to c1. So constant c1 is coming out to be 0. What is the second boundary condition again? X at L is 0. So this upon substitution will give you 0 is equal to c1 cos square root lambda L plus c2 sine square root lambda L. But c1 is already being computed, which is 0. So this will reduce to 0 is equal to c2 sine square root lambda L. Now from here, what do you get, right? Now again, we will say, since c2 is non-zero for the non-trivial solution, we are at a situation where we have c2 into sine of square root lambda L in 0. So if c2 will be 0, then again we will lead to the constant solution, the trivial solution, x is equal to 0. So we don't want that. We are trying to find if there exists a non-trivial solution. So we'll go with the case, okay, c2 is non-zero, but this sine square root of lambda L is 0, because for the product to be 0, that is the only possibility we are left with. Now, when this is going to happen, we know when sine of something is going to be 0. Yeah, so this implies square root of lambda L is equal to n pi. Now what is n? N is your, you know, the integers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. So we already know that there are infinitely many solutions for the same. So we are going to get this for this. From here you can compute the value of lambda. So square root of lambda is n pi by L, and lambda is equal to n square pi square by L square, because lambda was the constant introduced by us. Basically lambda was minus omega. If you remember, omega was substituted with minus lambda. So omega was the constant introduced by us. So we are ultimately finding its value from this. So that means if lambda is this value, then this problem is going to have a non-trivial solution. And what is that non-trivial solution now? X is equal to C2 sine root lambda. Root lambda is N pi by L into X. Because if you look at X, there is X, the general solution. X is C1 cos root lambda X plus C2 sine root lambda X. Now C1 is 0, but C2 is there, something non-zero constant, and root lambda we have just computed is N pi by L. So now you can see that here, this capital X is actually going to be, means from here, you can write it as xn is equal to cn sine n pi by lx, because there are now infinitely many solutions. There is no one non-trivial solution. There are infinitely many solutions, because sign is becoming zero at infinitely many values. So you put n is equal to one particular value, you will get one solution, capital X. You will put n is equal to two, you will get some another X. So you will get some family of solutions from there, not just one particular or solutions of one type, right? So this constant C2 will also change every time because different n, which will be substituted, the solution, because C2 is arbitrary constant, can have any value. So that also depends upon the value of n. If you get a new solution, you will get a new constant. So this depends upon n. So this gives me the infinitely many solutions of this equation. Yes, which equation we were solving? X double dash minus omega x is zero, where minus omega we put plus lambda, right? And lambda I know is positive. This along with these two boundary conditions, x at zero is zero and x at L is zero. So this system is having these many solutions, infinitely many solutions, right? So this was equation number five, which has been solved. Right, so I'm just going to tell you briefly what we did for this last case, if you have any confusion in this one. So the last case was omega is negative. So since omega is negative, I can write it as omega is minus lambda, where lambda is something positive. So this is purely for the convenience of mathematical notation. You can continue with minus omega then, but you have to remember that omega is negative, so minus omega is positive. So this is the convenient notation. So this gives me the complex roots of the auxiliary equation. Therefore, the general solution of the differential equation is going to be C1 times cos root lambda x plus C2 times sine root lambda x. And then I know I need to put the boundary conditions. So when I substituted the first boundary conditions, this was 0 is equal to C1 cos 0 plus C2 sine 0. So this gives me 0 is equal to C1 into 1 plus 0. So this is directly giving me C1 is equal to 0. Some of you is asking that why you have picked C1 is 0. I have not chosen C1 to be 0. I have not given that value C1 to be 0. It is mathematically by default coming automatically C1 is 0. So I cannot play around with C1 or I cannot control it. Okay, so C1 is coming out to be 0. So now we use the second boundary condition. So when you use the second boundary condition, you put X is equal to L and capital X is equal to 0. So 0 is equal to C1 cos square root lambda L plus C2 sine square root lambda L. So now I will be using that C1 has already been computed 0 from the first boundary condition. So I'll be putting C1 is 0. So ultimately I am here that I am getting 0 as a product of C2 and sine square root lambda L. Now here I have two possibilities. Either this can be 0 or this can be 0. So if C2 is 0, if C2 is 0, in that case, your X is going to be 0 again because your general solution is C1 times cos root lambda X plus C2 times. So C1 is already 0. If C2 is also 0, then you will again get what solution? Trivial solution, right? Now we will see what will happen if C2 is non-zero. So if C2 is non-zero, in that case, for this expression to be true, this quantity has to be 0. Sine of square root of lambda L has to be 0. And we know that when sine is 0, so sine is taking 0 values at root lambda L is equal to n pi, right? So why I have considered positive integers here? Because square root of any number is always positive. So square root of lambda is going to be positive quantity and capital L is the length of the rod. That also cannot be negative. So that is why this equation is valid. Although in general, when we write sine x is 0, we write x is equal to plus minus n pi, right? Negative integers are also allowed. But here, only positive integers will be allowed because these as a product is a positive number. And pi, of course, is positive. So n will be positive. So from here, I got that this condition is being satisfied. So you get lambda is n square pi square by L square. So now I substituted the values obtained. I did not get the value of C2. I could not obtain the value of C2. It is just remaining as such, but I obtained the value of lambda because you see the there were three constants involved. Two of them were arbitrary constant, which were part of the solution, but the third one was introduced by us in the beginning. So when you are using two conditions, so obviously you are evaluating two of them. So C1 has been evaluated, lambda has been evaluated, but C2 remains as an arbitrary constant. So that means for a non-trivial solution, this lambda should be there. And when you put it back into your general solution, I'll get x is equal to C2 times sine n pi by lx. Now these are infinitely many solutions because n can have infinitely many values. N is equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on. Agree with this? So I am denoting, I'm just putting the subscript xn because for every different n, I'll get a different x. So I need to make a name change, right? When I put n is equal to 1, I'll get some solution x1. When I put n is equal to 2, I'll get some solution x2 and so on. So you will get infinitely many solutions. So that's why this xn notation has been introduced. And same is what I have done with the arbitrary constant, because for a different n, the arbitrary constant can have a different value. So it be dependent on n. So for that also I have denoted with it Cn, right? So please ask if any doubt up till this point. Anybody has any doubt till this point? We have solved one of the equation with the boundary conditions. And let me show you, that was equation number 5. And now we need to solve the other equation, which is equation number 6. When I told you, we introduced two ordinary differential equations here. Yes. This was one of them. Equation number 5, we have solved completely and we have got a non-trivial solution. Now it's turn to solve equation number 6. For remember, for equation number 6, you will not be using any boundary conditions because this is with respect to time. So with respect to time, what condition will be used is the initial condition. So that part will come later. But firstly, let's solve this one. Yeah. So it's easy to solve this one because this is a first order ODE. Yes, how you are going to solve this one? So T dash is equal to omega KT. Now here also, if you want, you can make three cases, but otherwise, actually what you should do, you will start by putting omega is minus lambda, because already the solution of this part has been obtained by putting omega is equal to minus lambda. So that means the other two cases, omega zero or omega positive, they are kind of rejected cases. So because we are solving them as a, you know, combination, they are simultaneously to be solved. It's not like they are completely different. Finally, they are going to reflect u. So u is x into t. So if x is valid, the one the x which you have computed for omega negative case, so T also you will be computing for omega negative case, right? It's not possible because both of them are equal to the same constant. So for this, if you have used omega is minus lambda, so for this also you have to use the same value of omega, otherwise it does not make sense. Okay, so put omega is minus lambda, where we already know lambda actually. We already know this value of lambda. So firstly, we can solve it and then we can substitute this value of lambda. Okay, right. So it's easy to solve this equation. First order one, T dash is omega K by T. So I'm going to write its solution. So this is actually dT by T is equal to omega K, right? And omega is minus lambda K. K is also one of the constants. It's present in the system only. It's not an arbitrary constant. It's a part of the original problem. So let K be K. Yes. So now you can integrate this one very easily. You can find the solution. So log of T is equal to minus lambda KT plus, upon integration, it will introduce some arbitrary constant C3. So T is going to be e raised to power minus lambda KT into e raised to power C3. So T, I am writing some, you can say, B times e raised to power minus lambda KT, right? So this is very easy. I have just solved equation 6 and I have got this one. I need some more space, so I'm just shifting the page below. Let me write it again. Just a minute. Yeah, so we were here. So much scroll down. Yeah, so we were here t dash by t is equal to minus lambda k t. So the solution which we just obtained is actually turning out to be b times e raised to power minus lambda k t. Now this lambda which you have just obtained, you can substitute its value. So lambda is n square pi square by l square k t, right? So now this n, what was n? N is also 1, 2, 3 and so on, because the same value of lambda is having infinitely many values. So now this t is also going to have, capital T also going to have infinitely many values. So let me denote it by Tn is equal to Bn e raised to power minus n square pi square by l square k into t. So this is the solution. This is the infinitely many solutions for different values of n. Right? So we got xn, we got tn. So remember, what was your u? We are in the search of u. So u x t, if you remember, was capital X into capital T. So this time it is now xn into tn. It is like we were looking for one x and one t, but absolutely there is no one x and one t. There are infinitely many x and infinitely many t for different values of n. So the solutions for u are also going to be infinitely many depending upon the value of n. So un is going to be xn into tn. More precisely, you want to write, so un is equal to xn into tn. So now you put the value of xn. We have obtained xn above, right? So un is going to be xn we have just obtained above. I'm just going to substitute that one. So yeah, let me show you what was the xn which we obtained. This is cn sine n pi by lx. Cn sine n pi by lx. Yeah, so this is cn sine n pi by lx into tn. We need to multiply with tn. Tn is bn e raised to power minus n square by pi square by l square into kt. Now, what are n? N is 1, 2, 3 and so on. So we got infinitely many values of the solution which we were looking for u. That also has got these values. Now we just need to write it in a simplified form. So this cn, bn, these are both constants depending upon the value of n. Both of them are arbitrary constant. So their product, let me call it an, right? Sine n pi by lx into e raised to power this. So whatever. So cn into bn, I am writing it an. So this is my un. Right? So this is the family of solutions of one dimensional heat equation. Now this is in the most general form. So what point we can raise from here? Now if you remember, let me ask you a question that So if you have a differential equation which is having two different solutions, say y1 and y2, then y1 plus y2 is also a solution of the differential equation? Yes or no? If y1 is a solution of differential equation, y2 is another solution of differential equation, their addition, y1 plus y2, does that also going to be a solution of the differential equation? Yes. So we know this from the very fundamentals of the differential equation whenever we are talking about solutions. Now, since these uns are individually solutions, right? Now you will be putting n is equal to 1, you will get one solution u1. You put n is equal to 2, you will get another solution u2. You put n is equal to 3, you will get u3. So you keep on getting solutions like this. So if I ask you the most general solution, so that is actually going to be the sum of all these solutions, right? So the general solution which we always obtain is the by adding all the solutions. So these are actually going to be linearly independent, so we can add them, but right now we are not going to focus on proving that they are linearly independent, but let's just add them. So this is going to be your n square pi square by l square k into t. So this is going to be the most general form of heat equation, right? So one more thing now here, how you are going to get the value of an? If you remember your original problem, was uxx is equal to 1 by k times ut. So it had two boundary conditions and it had one initial condition. I'm telling you this from the beginning that this has been already incorporated, but this is still left. We have not anywhere used any initial condition, right? So this is the point now which we will be using the initial condition. So that means anytime whenever you are solving a question of heat equation, so up till this point it's just controlled by the boundary conditions. Now we are going to use the initial condition to get the value of arbitrary constant an. Is this point clear to all? So far we have not used initial condition, so we are going to now use that. So what is the initial condition? So if you remember, there was no particular initial condition given to you. So initial condition, I told you, is going to be some function of x. It can be a constant also in a particular case, but in general, it is given to be a function of x. So you put this, let me denote this by, say, double star. So every time I refer to the expression double star, so this means this expression we are talking about, right? So you put this in the general solution. So what you will get? So t is equal to 0. You have to put t is equal to 0. And in place of u, you have to put fx. So you will get f of x is equal to summation n is equal to 1 to infinity an sine n pi by lx. No substitution for x. X has to be remaining x only. Just for t, you have to put 0. So t is here, e raised to power 0. So this will be e raised to power 0. That will be 1. So this implies it is simply f of x is summation n is equal to 1 to infinity an sine n pi by lx. Now this looks familiar to us. And now you will see and remember, okay, we were doing the chapter of Fourier series. This looks like a Fourier series, right? Apart from this, in the previous two lectures, we never talked about Fourier series. We were always just solving the heat equation. Now here is the point we are going to connect it with the Fourier series. And there you will see how the Fourier series is going to be applied here to find the values of this. So you got this condition. So from here, you can find the value of an. Right. So now the question which I'm going to ask you is this: what kind of Fourier series it is? You all know Fourier series looks like it contains constant terms, it contains cosine term, but this is particularly containing only sine terms. This is only containing sine terms. And so that is a Fourier sine series, clearly. And more precisely, it is a Fourier half range sine series. Now, why half range? Remember your domain. You have a length of the rod, which is from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to L. So your domain is, your function is defined over a domain of 0 to L time. For Fourier series, for the full range Fourier series, we always have the functions defined like on the intervals minus L to L, minus pi to pi. But here, since our domain is 0 to L, so it is going to be a Fourier half range series and containing only sine terms. So this is Fourier half range sine series. Because in half range, we either have cosine series or we have sine series. So this one is Fourier half range sine series. So now let me ask you, what will be an? If this is Fourier half range series, Fourier half range sine series, what is the value of an? It is 2 by L 0 to L f of x sine n pi by L x into dx. That is how we compute the constants. So whenever we write a function's expansion as a Fourier series, that summation a n cos n pi by L x plus b n sine n pi by L x, then we know how to compute a n and b n. They are integrals. So same is here what we are doing. It is just, don't get confused. Usually in Fourier series, we have a n with cos, b n with sine, but that's just a name. You can have call this a n or b n also. So this, if you want to feel more comfortable, you want to feel exactly the way we did in Fourier series, so I can call it b n, because usually the coefficient of sine is b n. That's just a notation, doesn't matter. So you got the value of a n, because now we can solve this integral, because this will be given to us in the question. So you see, the whole question can be solved without the use of initial condition. It is just in the end you want to compute this a n using this definition, right? So let me just write the summary what we have done. So summary is, this is your equation, ut is equal to k times uxx. So we write it in this forms, where x is having the domain, it's 0 to L, L being the length of the rod, and t is positive, t is obviously the time. So in this case, it's solution. The generalized solution is uxt is summation n is equal to 1 to infinity a n sine n pi by L x into e raised to power minus n square pi square by L square into kt. So k will be coming from the problem, that will be given to you. L will be given to you, the length of the rod, and a n needs to be computed. So where a n is 2 by L 0 to L f of x sine n pi by L x dx. Now what is f of x? So this was given with two initial conditions. Two boundary conditions were the zero temperature, and this one is the initial condition. So remember, this solution which we have obtained is for zero temperature boundary conditions. If it would have been something else, then the solution can be different. So this is the complete solution. So now, what kind of questions will be asked from here? That they will give you some particular fx, and then they will ask you find the solution of the heat equation. So now let me give you the example of such a question. So the question will be like, solve the one-dimensional heat equation with zero temperature boundary conditions and given that initially the rod was immersed in boiling water at temperature 100 degree C. So the initially the rod means the complete rod. So zero temperature boundary conditions means you are given the boundary condition and heat equation already you know. So it is this information only which will vary in question to question. So you have to interpret the information and write it in the mathematically form, right? So can you tell me what is the meaning of this information? So the meaning of this information is, you are given the initial condition. So what is the initial condition given to me? U at x is equal to 0. Yes. What should I write here? Initially, the rod was immersed in boiling water at temperature 100 degree C. That means initially you gave your rod a temperature of 100 degree C. So the initially temperature of the rod was 100. So this is how you have to interpret. zero temperature, these are boundary conditions. That is something we already know. U at zero T is zero is equal to UF L of T. So that is something we know, but this is zero temperature boundary conditions. And yeah, one more thing is given to you. Given that initially the rod of length pi. So you are also given the length of the rod. You are given this L is equal to pi because L is going to be a variable. It can be given to you 1, 2, whatever in this question is given to you pi. So yes, this is the initial condition, which I told you that in general, u at x0 is fx. But here, in this particular question, fx is equal to a constant. So that's it. You are given the value of fx is equal to 100. So directly you compute the value of an, because as per this, you already derived the solution. You just need to compute the value of an. What is an? An is this formula. 2 by L, 0 to L, fx sine n pi by lx. So you also put L is equal to pi now because length of the rod is given to you. And you also put the value of fx, which is equal to 100. And so this will give me an. And once I get an, I get the solution. So it is 2 by pi, 0 to pi fx into sine. So in place of fx, I have put it 100. N pi by L, L is pi, x dx. So 100 can be taken outside, 200 by pi, 0 to pi sine n x, because, you know, pi gets cancelled. So now you can solve this one. Yes, what is the integral? Minus cos nx by n, because that's the integral of sine, 0 to pi. So it's 200 by pi n. The minus can also be taken outside. Cos n pi minus cos 0. So everybody knows now what is cos n pi? Minus 1 raised to power n. What is cos 0? It is 1. So this is the value of an which you obtained. And you can see there is no problem with n coming in the denominator because your n starts from 1. So an is 200 by n pi, 1 minus minus 1 raised to power n. So you got the value of an. So therefore, the solution which we were talking about, you have to write uxt is summation n is equal to 1 to infinity an. An is 200 by n pi, 1 minus minus 1 raised to power n into sine n pi by lx. L is again pi, so this is sine nx into e raised to power, what is your term, n square pi square by l square. So L is equal to pi, this will get cancelled, e raised to power minus n square k t. So this is the final answer. K, if K is also given to you in the question, then you can use that. But if K is not given, you can keep the answer in this form only. Right? If they give you the value of K, you can substitute. If they don't give you the value of K, you can leave it like this. So I can just do a modification here. So like here, the statement was... Okay, just a minute. Yeah. Here the statement was solve the one-dimensional heat equation. So they are giving you uxx is 1 by k times ut. In particular case, they can also give you in particular solve ut is equal to uxx. So you will see that, okay, this is also a heat equation, but k is 1, right? So all what you have to do is to just identify ki general aapko pata hai usme kya kya given hai, k given hai, l given hai, function given hai. So now you can see the rest of the questions are going to be like this only. It is just this fx can vary, the length of the rod can vary, and the value of k can be given to you, right? So this completely solves this question. So we can do one more example for the same, but in the next class. But now I can take your doubts. Please raise your hands in case you have doubts. Yes.
हमने y1 मैम इनफाइनाइट सॉल्यूशन आए थे y1 y2 y इनफिनिटी हमने ऐड करके मैम सॉल्यूशन बनाया मैम, ये तो फिर एक सॉल्यूशन हुआ ना मैम, वो सेपरेटली टर्म्स भी तो सॉल्यूशन थी, तो हमने उन सॉल्यूशन के वो जो कांस्टेंट था उनके लिए तो डिटरमाइन नहीं किया।
कौन से कांस्टेंट की बात कर रहे हैं
हम? जो मैम हमें इनफाइनाइट सॉल्यूशन मिल गए थे ना जिसको हमने ऐड करके सीरीज बना दी थी हम, तो वो ऐड करके जो सीरीज बनी जैसे y1 प्लस y2 एक सॉल्यूशन हो गया मैम, तो टोटल में अगर हम अगर दो ही होते तो एक्चुअल में तीन सॉल्यूशन मिल गए हम, तो
जब आपको ऐसे ऐड करके सॉल्यूशन बनाते हो तो वो तीन नहीं है, उसको एक ही बोला जाता है। मतलब ऐसे तो आपसे ऐसे पूछा जाए व्हाट आर द नंबर ऑफ सॉल्यूशंस ऑफ ईच इक्वेशन, यू विल से इनफाइनाइट, so give me the most general form of the solution, so you will say this is the most general form, so if somebody will ask give me just one solution of it, so you can put any particular value of n, you put n is equal to 3, that is one of the solution, you just take one term out of that summation, that is going to be one solution, right? You can put n is equal to 50 and just capture that 50th term, that is also a solution, but the most general solution is means you write it in the summation form. It is not one solution, it is the general form of the solution which contains individually infinitely many solutions, a sum. So this is how, you know, in partial differential equation things happen. In ordinary differential equation, the difference is there you get, you know, finitely many solutions because of the fixed order and these things like that. But in PDE, the things are little like this because you are having this sine and cosine, Fourier series kind of solutions. So...
हम तो ये जर्नल कैसे है मैं, मतलब ये जो पूरी सीरीज है ये उस पर्टिकुलर वाले को कैसे रिप्रेजेंट करेगी? कोई एक
आप उसको जनरल सॉल्यूशन वो मत सोचो, जो जनरल सॉल्यूशन हम ओडी में कहते हैं कि ये जनरल सॉल्यूशन है, ये पर्टिकुलर सॉल्यूशन है, हम सिर्फ इतना कह रहे हैं ये जनरलाइज्ड फॉर्म ऑफ सॉल्यूशन है कि आपके इनफिनिटली मेनी सॉल्यूशंस इसी में हैं, राइट? तो ये इस पूरी डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन को जो भी ये यू है, इस पूरे इनफिनिट समेशन को जो भी ये फंक्शन रिप्रेजेंट कर रहा है, अब इसको अगर अपनी हीट इक्वेशन में सब्स्टिट्यूट करोगे ut is equal to k times uxx, this will satisfy, this is a solution, ये infinite many is a solution, इसमें से कोई एक ले लोगे, मान लो n को मैंने 55 ले लिया, तो मैंने सिर्फ एक टर्म उठाई, वो भी सेटिस्फाई करेगा बिकॉज वो सारे इंडिविजुअली भी उसके सोल्यूशन है, उनमें से कोई दो उठा लो, दोनों को एड कर दो, वो भी सोल्यूशन है, वो भी सेटिस्फाई करेगा। सो बेसिकली ऑल द finitely many combinations are also solution, individually also they are solutions, but individually jab wo solutions honge tab constant determine karne ka tarika jo hai alag ho jayega, agar aap starting se individually karte ho, agar aap yahan tak aake ab individually pick karna chahte ho to aap koi bhi ek particular n pick kar lo, that is just particular solution because ye koi bhi arbitrary solution nahi hai, इसको उस सेंस में मत सोचो ये कि जनरल सॉल्यूशन है, इट शुड कंटेन आर्बिट्ररी कांस्टेंट, देयर इज नो आर्बिट्ररी कांस्टेंट, के इज अ कांस्टेंट बट वो आर्बिट्ररी नहीं है, वो तो सिस्टम का ही पार्ट है, के की तो वैल्यू मैं अभी आपको दे दूं तो एक बहुत ही सॉल्यूशन बन जाएगा, बट एक्चुअली दीज काइंड ऑफ सॉल्यूशंस ऑफ डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन आर नोन एज सीरीज सॉल्यूशंस, सो ये ओडी से डिफरेंट होते हैं। सीरीज सॉल्यूशन में फिर हमारे पास टेलर सीरीज होते हैं, पावर सीरीज होते हैं, ये हमारे पास फोरियर सीरीज सॉल्यूशन है। So don't get confused with the word general. यहाँ पे general का वो meaning नहीं है।
Okay ma'am. और ma'am हमने t dash को differentiate किया था, मतलब small t के respect में क्या था ना?
हाँ हाँ हाँ. Yeah, let me just show you that part again because somebody else is also asking that. जब हमने t dash को solve किया था, where is that part gone? Yeah, here it is. Yes. So this is obviously this capital T is a function of T. So this is dt by capital T is omega k. So yeah, oh sorry, मैंने यहाँ लिखा नहीं. dt है यहाँ पे. Sorry, this is dt. Then we'll when you will integrate, now you'll get that this t dash is d of t by d of t small t. So separation of variables will give you this. Oh yes, we are done with time. Yeah, sorry, I just need to finish this one. Thank you.